So the Mesh X-Rite 660 single cylinder. You buy this bike because you want an A2 bike, because this is an A2 bike that you can have fun with on all the roads you might encounter. You just want to have an adventure. And you want a classic look? Well, here you have it. So while leading the group ride, I was able to absolutely godsmack this bike across. Beautiful roads, corners, straights, many more corners. And it did not let me down in the corners. It actually surprised me a little bit in the corners. Because some of the reviews said, well, you have knobby tires on it, which they are. More like the looks than actually full off-road tires. And yes, they are like a semi unknown brand. But I removed practically all the chicken strips on it. Now that is partly due to the fact that I do negative leaning or counter leaning. So I let the bike do most of the leaning while I stay quite upright. And that's just how I learned myself riding. So during the group ride, once or twice I tried to hang off the bike. And especially if you put like your proper foot placement, you can actually grab the tank quite well with your knee and actually hang off the bike. Look past your mirror, and you can actually maintain that angle quite well in the corner. Switching around is a little bit more difficult, but then again, this is not that type of bike. If you really want to go full at it, you probably buy a sports bike or maybe a semi-naked or sport tourer. But it can do it, and that is what these types of bikes, the XT, the Desert Sled, this beautiful X-Rite, for some people even a Trans Alp, stuff like that, are proper all-rounders, and I like that. I do want to mention though that one of the things I do think it could improve this bike a little bit more is different tires. From memory, 17 inch front and rear, and I don't know if that was planned or they listen to people that give Mesh advice, but there is a model coming which has 18 and 21 inch wheels and tires, and I think that would suit this bike so much more. Now everything you touch, like the levers, the brake pedal, the shifter, all feels very, very sturdy. Not something the old Mesh had, but definitely something the new Mesh has. And you can change gears and brake with your rear so rapidly that it makes fun to corner. It is very light. I cannot remember if it was 177 or 163 emptied. But yeah, very light. You can easily make it lighter if you want to. And I have an XT 660 at home. So big part of you wants to compare these two. And they are not really comparable, as in Euro 5 to whatever that old beast is. I think Euro 2. But they are both single cylinders. The fact that it is a single cylinder does mean that it's not for everybody. It does vibrate a little bit. The most vibration you notice is in the mirrors, which there's no problem, that has, my XT has the same problems. It's barely in the handles. The handlebar itself is somewhat off-road. You could like do like one of those rental bar protectors here. But vibration in that steer, in that handlebar, is so limited. It is there, sometimes you can notice, especially if you only have one hand on the steering wheel, then you can feel it a little bit. But it is not that present. Honestly, I can tell you from riding, again, the XT, that one has way more vibrations in its steer. And it even has handguards, so it has added weight, which should limit vibrations. Do you feel the vibrations? Yes. Tank, your seat a little bit, And your foot pegs. The foot pegs is the most noticeable. And even then, it's not bad. You can ride this beast for 6 hours. I've done so. Without having any problems with vibrations on your foot pegs. I can tell you this much, during the group rides, when my toes were on the foot peg as such, I hit the ground with my toes, so that means the foot pegs are getting close. I heard it scrape again. That is how far you can lean this bike on the cheaper knobby tires. These are not Pirellis, these are whatever brand they are. It does have semi-off-road foot pegs, so standing up on them you have more than enough grip to stand on them and stay securely on there. Or the seat, surprisingly very very comfy, way more comfy than I anticipated. They really hit the nail with this saddle, and it still gives more than sufficient grip. Especially if you ride it a little bit more spicy. Of course, the number of horses is not that great, but it is what you're paying for, if that makes sense. Because it is, what is it, 6,000, 7,000 euros roughly here in the Netherlands. Different countries have it cheaper. And if you look at, like, for example, the XT, which is growing in price, you can buy an XT for 5,000. But then you have an XT with 50,000 kilometers on it, no guarantee, no warranty, no whatever. But you can buy this one, brand spanking new. And do remember, this engine only has like almost 800 kilometers on it. Less than 400 when I got it. So it's still like new. I must say, even today I'm still a little bit lucky with the weather. Because it is late and the sun is still shining bright. Barely, but still. So let's talk about one of two downsides of this bike. Real proper downsides. And the biggest one of those two is the gas tank. Gets you 100 to 150 kilometers. And then that light starts to blink because the sun is less bar, so it's getting empty. I have no idea how that long that less bar is. I don't tend to find that out, but yeah, that's a downside for me. I know for some people 100 kilometers or 120 kilometers is more than enough. I know some Harley riders, chopper riders, who do perfectly with that range. Personally, I would like a little bit more. And the weird thing is, there's more than enough room here for a bigger gas tank. More than enough room. But the gas tank as is very pleasing for the look and for the eye. I think that is part of the reason, if not the full reason, why they went with a smaller gas tank. Now I do wonder how much the look will change if you get 21 and 19 inch or 21 and 18 inch wheels under it, because it will lift part of the machine. So maybe there's a room for at least another liter or two possible in that gas tank. But I don't like that I have to fuel every other day. I don't like that I do a group ride and people are waiting for me because I'm the one who has to fill up. The other complaint I have is that the engine gets a little bit too hot too fast. Obviously it's a single cylinder, obviously it will get hot. Most logical, yes. That being said, it has a very very tiny radiator. Very tiny radiator. And I don't think that helps much with cooling the engine. Again, probably looks versus usability. Does it hurt the bike? For as far as I can tell, no. Does it hurt me? For as far as I can tell, no. The exhaust near your right leg has a heat shield, and it seems to do its job very, very nicely. Quick about the looks. Classic look. White, black, red. Perfect composition. Like I said, knobby tires, somewhat knobby tires. Dual exhaust, even though it's a single cylinder, which I like. Nice protector on the bottom, so it shows it can do and will do off-road. Single disc front, big one. Single disc on the rear, a little bit smaller one. The front is really, really clean. look at it light, LED of course, indicators also LED, which personally I do like. I don't know why that is blue, I would have changed it either black or red, but other space, your battery, not much space, but everything is here, easy, accessible. You do get looks with this bike, and that was the same with the scrambler desert sled. It's probably because it is white, probably because there's a classic look, so people are curious what it is. In that regard, I mean, must admit, Mesh did place down a good looking classic styled bike, which I did, I don't know, 400 something kilometers on, so I do have a little bit knowing of what I'm saying. It's just a shame that due to the circumstances I have to do it in a little bit of a rush. I was talking about the front suspension. It is a special like bronze type color, not gold like you see on a lot of bikes, also not black, but it's bronze-ish color, and I really like that. That's something of a detail. Right, a little bit of roadie. With the stock exhaust, it is quiet, but still gives a nice sound, a nice growl. So yeah, I'm fine with that. I don't think that is any, don't think that's a downside. Some people have complaints about your dash, and they prefer a kilometer needle, but I like it. I mean, I can see the digital stuff easily enough to have a good idea what speed I'm going. Let's just do the overall. I know I'm not there yet, but let's do the overall. I'm very positive. Yes, it does lack a little bit of power compared to bigger brands, but it's also roughly half the price. What do you guess? But it looks good. It looks very good. It feels good when you hit that power band. Roughly 3,500 RPMs and up. Gear, lever and your clutch, everything works so nicely, so easily, so quickly. But yeah man, for an A2 bike, especially if you like this style, if you want an all-round bike, the competition is not that big. The moment you keep price in your mind, there's hardly any competition really. Himalayan 450cc is a fun bike. The Himalayan is better at the off-road stuff. I know, I also did the Himalayan. But yeah, it's not as fast as this bike. It does not have the acceleration power as this bike. And now we have two bikes to chase. And these are bigger bikes. And yet we can catch up. But yeah man, this is definitely a fun bike. Good A2 bike. Not the best, but definitely a good one. It's a little bit more power and you have an awesome bike. This might be, and this is a very big statement I'm gonna say, this might be the best Mesh I've driven so far. And I really like the Mesh Scrambler 400 that they had a couple of years ago. And if I had to buy with my own money either the X-Ride Mesh or the Himalayan Royal Enfield, it would be a terrible difficult choice, but I think it will become this one. If I had to choose, I'd rather buy this bike and throw another 1,000 euros against it to remove some of the Euro 5 restrictions, maybe to get it flashed, maybe different exhaust for a little bit more sound and stuff like that, and I have actually have a fun but way cheaper bike like I said, I semi like this more than the Ducati Desert Sled. And maybe at a little bit too high anticipation for that bike, but that's the same anticipation as for this bike, so other than power. I did anticipate that the Ducati Desert Sled had more power, and it didn't. And this bike, you know, it's a mesh, so you know it has a little bit less. And there's another problem. You pay far less so that it has a little bit less. Who gives a shit? But yeah, very positive. Three small downsides. One, I think it, yeah, so the gas tank is too small. The engine that gets too hot too quickly for my liking. And the fact that I cannot seem to find neutral from first. I always have to go to second and then go back to neutral. It has so many positives. I like the details and colors. I like the fact that you can just turn your ABS off with a button. The look in general. And but let's end on this note. I'm very, very, very interested in the 1821 version, inch tires, wheels, you know what I mean, next year's model. I think that can be very promising as well. And with that, I'm gonna end it really this time. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and I will see you guys in the next one.